So this is actually a departure for you to be a documentarian.
Yeah.
But you've kind of been a documentarian, it seems like, before anybody else was, almost. I seem to recall you being an early C-band aficionado.
Oh, well, yeah, yeah. I've been documenting that stuff. These art pieces that I do them as art pieces just because that appeals to my sense of humor, of people waiting to go on television. I've been documenting that stuff for, but that's, you know, that's, I guess the difference between that is it's content free. And this is content rich.
But would you consider yourself an information, a news geek? I mean, is
that... Oh, absolutely. I mean, you know, I think in a way, my purpose in doing this movie was to fill this hole, this vacuum that was left when the news media abandoned the story and also mm-hmm. the idea of doing full-length documentaries that I grew up watching, you know, when they were on network television. Doesn't that sound quaint? So absolutely. And I worked, you know, I had a youthful career in journalism. Well, I say journalism, I worked at Newsweek. But no, I worked in a
lot of...
That
was once a real magazine?
I hear tell. But I did a lot of journalistic work. I was a reporter and a writer for a lot of publications, so I'd had that experience.
So did you give up on that because you were funny, or...?
I gave up on that because I found that the people I wanted to write about were people I basically didn't like, and that I had to pretend to like them to get near enough to them to write about them, and I thought, maybe I'll just be far away from them and make fun of them instead.
So had you... I guess
you know, like, if I had ever thought about being trapped in a room with Richard Nixon, who fascinated me, you know, but, you know, I like making fun of him. Same with a lot of other people.
Distance is good.
Yeah.
So you, I guess you've seen all the documentaries, or many of the documentaries about this...
About New Orleans, the flood.
And the flood that came out very quickly.
Yeah.
After the movie, but they weren't... The answers were not there that you were...
They weren't even asking the questions. They were, you know, look, suffering people. Mm-hmm. And wallowing, I think, in many cases, not all, in the emotionality of it. An anchor for one of the network broadcasts put it most pithily to me when I asked why people who watched that broadcast didn't know why New Orleans had flooded. Mm. And the answer was, and I think this is an exact quote, we just feel the emotional stories are more compelling for our audience. So, you know, I think that, and then there was a backlash. Mm. Some of those same anchors were complaining that they were getting emails from viewers saying, why are you still on this New Orleans story? Hmm. Because, understandably, they were feeling emotionally bludgeoned. Suffering happens everywhere.
Right.
Why is it important to me? It's important to you because you paid to help destroy the city. And that's the part that hadn't been told.
So you dove back into New Orleans pretty quickly after all this happened.
I got back in November 5th, which is approximately 2 months after the flood.
So do you have survivor's guilt? I mean, do you have a...
No, not at all.
Was it odd going back into the midst of it as things were really rough at that point?
It was bizarre. It was, you know, look, I mean, the Sunday after the flooding happened, I did a radio show that was basically a summation of everything I thought and felt about a city I thought I'd never see again in anything remotely recognizable. Mm. So when I came back, it wasn't remotely recognizable. Mm. The only vehicles on the streets were National Guard Humvees. I had the first meal in a restaurant in the French Quarter, a particular restaurant in French Quarter that was served on non-paper plates because they just gotten their hot water back. Refrigerators were lining every street because whether you'd been flooded or not, you'd been without electricity for 6 weeks. Your refrigerator was toast. Mm-hmm. Not a toaster, but right. It was, you know, there were 10,000 abandoned cars under the overpass of the Interstate 10. There was a mountain of flood debris, three stories tall and a mile long, down one of the major the median strip of one of the major boulevards leading to the lake. I mean, it was just everywhere you looked, there was sights and smells that you never imagined. You know, the city was pitch dark at night. You know, a lot of it. There was no mail. I mean, it was not like anything you would recognize as a modern American city. It was very strange. But, you know, the main thing was people who lived, as we did, far enough away from one of the Corps of Engineers, protective structures were okay. And most everybody I knew had gotten through it okay. So there was the foundation to... And since my home was not damaged, you talk about guilt, I just poured the energy that other people were pouring into rebuilding or arguing with insurance companies or all of that into paying attention and having these folks on my radio show and blogging about it and thinking, okay, I was doing enough, until President Obama came to town in 2009, October, and called it a natural disaster. And I just realized, blogging, radio, what are you talking about? And that's when I decided to make the film.
Because it could actually have a more solid impact than any...
That was my thought, yeah. That's, you know, we now have this new tradition of feature documentaries playing in theaters and reaching the audience with information that they weren't getting through the standard channels, and compellingly enough, would have much more impact than what I'd been doing up to that time. At least that was my assumption.
So was it a deep research dig for you, or was it there and just nobody was actually talking about it?
Oh, both. I mean, because I'd been following it, because I'd been interviewing these people, I knew a lot of the story already. So it was easy to basically get a documentary done more quickly than an ordinary documentary would be done. I mean, we were less than 8 months. Beginning to end. But there was a lot of research to find, you know, I remembered things. I remembered that Max Mayfield, head of the National Hurricane Center, had said in December of 2005 that Katrina, by the time it passed by New Orleans, was at most a weak Category 2 or a strong Category 1 hurricane, which totally blew that the big one stuff out of the water. So now I had to go find video of him saying that to put in the film. So, you know, there was a lot of that kind of research. Ray Seed, one of the co-leaders of the Berkeley investigation, for reasons of his own, didn't want to be in the film. But I knew that he'd written this letter to the American Society of Civil Engineers, and I thought maybe there was video of him. So I was doing video and research like that to find his stuff. So
and did you hold that? I mean, the whole thing of him, because Ray is a big character in the movie, one of the big four or five.
Yeah.
Did you feel like he was copping out by not participating? Did you feel like he was just protecting himself at that point?
Because when you see what happens to the people who stood up and told the truth about this, you can't be judgmental that somebody doesn't want more of that crap coming their way, I don't think.
So he probably already went through a storm having written that letter.
Yeah, I assume so. But so, and we had, you know, a couple of researchers on staff as well doing more of that. So there, it was both that I knew the story and that we had a lot of research to do.
So how did you approach the idea of how you wanted to tell the story? It's a big bite.
Yeah, well, I mean, it was in reaction to that statement of, we just feel the emotional stories are more compelling for our audience, that I now said, okay, I have 90 minutes, because coming from comedy, you don't want to ever go beyond 90 minutes. I have 90 minutes to undo 5 years of media misinformation. I could be a confusing presence in this. So in the first iteration of the film, I wasn't in it at all. I wasn't on screen at all. So because I wasn't going to be on screen, I didn't want the people in the film talking to an off-camera interviewer. I wanted them looking directly at the lens. I knew I wanted that because this was going to be distracting. Who are they talking to? I'm not in it. No, I'm not there. Also, I thought that it was more powerful for them to be telling the story directly to the audience. I knew I wanted really good cinematography. I wanted people, as they're talking about something, standing in front of it or near it. So we're not only telling you about it, but we're showing it at the same time. I knew that because there's technical stuff involved and because people really didn't understand the scope of the event, I wanted computer imagery to kind of make that vivid for you.
Right.
I knew I wanted music which was of New Orleans, but not cliche New Orleans music, which is why I asked Mr. Tarkanowski, a friend and a great composer and great instrumentalist, to do the music.
And we hear a great basketball player, he tells us.
I didn't say he was a great truth teller. And actually, he offered to do the music, I should point that out. I didn't want it to be an educational film. I wanted it to be the experience you'd have of seeing a motion picture. But I wanted it to be focusing on the information. Now, I talked to the principals, Bobby Ivervan Heerden and Maria Garzino, but the only one I'd, for my radio show, but the only one I'd met was Ivor. So when we went and shot Bob and we went and shot Maria, and I noticed the crew's reaction to them was very powerful. And I realized, without doing a story with suffering footage, we had an emotional story, the story of what happened to these three people, the guts that took to do what they did, and the whacking they got for doing it. So that was the bonus, that we got a story, you know. That.
So you found that that as a central theme as you went?
Yeah.
Were there other things that you thought it was going to be that it turned out not to be, or?
No, I mean, I just wanted it to be the story of this event, start to finish.
Right.
And always with what the consequences were.
Right.
But I just didn't know that people would respond to them as strongly as they did. But I saw what the crew's response was, and I thought, okay.
So you ended up doing some walk and talk in the first act,
yes,
particularly.
Yes, after we showed it to an audience, they said, we need somebody to sort of guide us through this. So I thought, oh, that I can do. I'm not going to be on screen talking about engineering, but I'll tell you who, you know, I'll guide you through it.
But you kind of disappear in the second, as you get to later in the
picture.
You
see these same people again. I don't have to keep reintroducing them. You know, I'm basically welcoming you into this world and sort of guiding you through this world. But then, yeah, you're on your own with these folks because they're the ones who know what they're talking about. You don't need me there.
Right. And as you got to Ask a New Orleanian, was that a process of having that roundtable interview, that the five of you sitting there at the table, or six of you, and needing a way to process it as a, in terms of the documentary? Or?
Well, that was always part of my plan, because I felt a film so dense with information needed to give the audience breathers. You know, a little chance every once in a while to kind of just, okay, I got that. Give me a second before the next.
Right.
And also, these canards that had been, I'd been dealing with them at the Huffington Post, you know, commenters saying, well, why don't you just move the city? And I thought they needed to be addressed, but I also wanted to show New Orleans people kind of the way people get together and kind of talk serious stuff but with a sardonic sense of humor ambient in the conversation. So I wanted to show that too. I thought that was as a breather, that would be a good way to lighten the pace of the movie and to give that little 2-minute pause before, okay, we're back with the heavy stuff.
Well, it's interesting that in an odd way, the flood, the tsunami in Japan and all the coverage of that has kind of made the way you do the graphics and everything in this even more familiar. It feels like something we've actually seen, even though we've never seen it in this context.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if there'd been a helicopter with a camera over New Orleans at 5:30 in the morning on Monday, August 29th, it would have looked exactly like what we've seen in Japan.
Yeah.
I mean, I wish I'd had the money to make it look like that.
Right.
But that's exactly how it would have looked, you know, and people were acting as if, God, this has never happened before. Well, yeah, it happened here.
Yeah. No, it's stunning, and it's the specifics of how things broke down and how they repeatedly broke down is kind of the
sort of the same model.
I mean, you can't, but I mean, you just it's breathtaking when you haven't heard it after all these years, when this is the first time you're really getting a clear. I mean, I think that having read some things that you know that there were failures that were with the Army Corps of Engineers, but you don't realize how small they were, you know, how little it took to unearth the whole thing, to really...
Well, I mean, it was a succession of failures over four and a half decades, and some of them were really big and basic, and some of them were small. But I think, you know, the first thing it was important for me to do with the film was every congressperson who had ever been down to New Orleans, and there was a group in New Orleans that had as its one purpose, getting everybody in Congress down there to see with their own eyes, which they got about 40%, I think, or 50. But they would always say, God, I had no idea the scope of this thing. Mm-hmm. And they're right, they had no idea. So I thought the first job in the movie was to say, you have no idea how big this thing was and how fast it happened. What we don't point out is the consequences of the speed were the immediate cutting off of communications, which is why people on one side of town thought they dodged a bullet when the hurricane passed by, not knowing that already on the other side of the town, hideous, horrendous, disastrous, murderous flooding had already taken place because communications had been totally cut. But I did think it was really important to start the thing off with that. You have to grasp how big this thing was first. And I think I wanted to make that powerful as I could.
Well, I think the you do it without being sentimental, as you said from the beginning.
It's kind of. I mean, I try as hard as I can to not, you know, push those same buttons you've had pushed over and over and over again. You know?
Well, it starts to really talk about the survival. I mean, the instinct to survival and the cleaning up and the idea of people really just kind of getting their hands dirty and getting to work and.
I mean, look, I was in the city all during the time that people were spending. I have to say that one of the most moving things about the whole period was the first Mardi Gras. It's 6 months along. There's a big argument. Should we even have it? You know, what message are we sending to the rest of the world? You've been in this disaster, and now you're having this celebration. And the answer that came and that was ultimately... victorious was, this is what we do. They're not going to stop it. This is what we do. This is part of the way we live. And it was 2.5 weeks where people who had been spending all day long gutting their houses, getting rid of crap, you know, getting debris out, arguing with insurance companies, arguing with the guy from the government, arguing with the contractors, came out into the streets and watched this large, beautiful editorial cartoon denouncing everybody, including the Corps, who'd been responsible for this disaster. Nagin, Blanco, Bush, everybody. Rollickingly funny denunciations of all these people. I couldn't think of another city that whose, you know, civic reaction would be to laugh, to mock the people who'd almost destroyed them, and then go back and get back into the muck the next day.
Is that experience part of the kind of rebuilding of the lines of communication in the community? Or did the community rebuild that? Was that the first thing that came back?
Well, I mean, lines, you know, physical, actual lines of communication took a while. You know, phone, I mean, everything was flooded out for 6 weeks. And people ask why it was easier for Mississippi to clean up than New Orleans. Mississippi had a one-day hurricane disaster. Hurricane knocks everything down and moves along. This city sat underwater for 6 weeks. Everything that's underground, all the subterranean infrastructure is screwed up by that. So in terms of actual physical lines of communication, it took a while. In terms of human lines of communication, this is a city that before the flood was the statisticians call it the highest nativity rate in the country, meaning the city with the largest number of people born in the city still living there. People live near their grandfather, their grandparents, and their parents, and it's very tightly knit tapestry. That's ripped apart when this thing happens. And that's been knitting that back together through traditions and rituals and celebrations and commemorations and funerals and all the rest of it. That's been a big part of the work.
because that seems like New Orleans has always seemed like part of a unique town in that regard. Like that's part of the vibe you get when you go there as an outsider, even that it is all connected in a way that you can't understand unless you're part of it.
Yeah, and why a disaster like that was so much more psychologically devastating for a town that's so connected than to a town of individuals. Because
LA would have no problem.
Well, you know,
I'm sadly.
Not, yeah, but I mean, it is worse because these support systems are really profound, and by the way, and I don't say this to point fingers, but I'm pointing fingers. When you have that kind of event happening to that tightly woven a city, you have really serious mental health issues. Among a large part of the population. And 80% of the mental health practitioners left town. Mm. Not a good thing.
I guess because they could afford to?
Well, you know, there were hospitals that closed and they were now saying, well, where am I supposed to practice? Well, rent a freaking storefront, buddy. People need you here.
So is there a point where, was there a tipping point to the positive that you feel like has been hit?
Well, I think as we started to make the film, the Saints won the Super Bowl and Ray Nagin's term as mayor ended. And you can almost feel the city levitate from the congruence of both events. And that really felt, for better or worse, I mean, that's not to say that the city doesn't still have serious problems and challenges, but it really felt as though 2010 marked the end of the post-Katrina era. And then we're now in whatever era this is, it's come next. But that felt like that first 5 years sort of had concluded that process. You know, you say concluded, that there, you still never know, you know, who you see in town has got images of finding their dead parents in their attic running through their head. I mean, those tapes don't stop.
And how far along did you say the city is? I mean, is it 80% now or?
Population wise?
You know, population in terms of rebuilding what was destroyed?
Depends. Homeowners got a lot of support, grudging, filled with red tape. But still, there was about $10 billion of federal money appropriated ultimately and distributed to help compensate homeowners. Nothing similar happened for people who own rental housing. So you have probably 40,000 units of rental housing that's still not back up, which is why you have working class people who, for at least that reason, I think that's one reason why they haven't been able to come back, because rents have spiked. So you have a city that's got more expensive to live in.
Which is kind of stunning, actually, when you think about that.
Yeah, yeah.
You would think it would be the opposite. You would think it would be.
Yeah, but when you don't rebuild rental housing, that's what happens. You have a city that hundreds more restaurants than before the flood. The music scene as vibrant as ever, an art scene that has been, I think, energized and electrified by that experience that people have gone through. A lot of reform on the, in terms of the government institutions that had problems, either corruption or just lack of competence type problems.
Because of forces in the community?
Organized by people in the community, basically.
Just had enough, finally. And
basically, like, this is the time to do this. You know, we gotta mobilize and get a smarter type of community to respond to this. So they reformed the levy boards, reformed the tax assessors. You know, there's a wave of reform and a wave of community. There were meetings in neighborhoods all over the city. I went to a lot of them. Some of them were because in the early days there were all these maps that came out of how the new New Orleans should look. And people woke up in the morning and looked in their newspaper and saw there was a green dot over their neighborhood. Mm-hmm. Well, that's going to be green space. And they went, no, I live here. So there were a lot of community organizations that sprang up to defend, revive neighborhoods. A lot of neighborhoods came back because one person came back and then started calling their neighbors and saying, I'm back, would you come back? And growing that way, regrowing that way. A lot of young kids came down to volunteer, either with faith-based or secular groups, and, and realized, wow, this is a special place, and there's a lot of opportunity here. So Tulane University's applications have like doubled and tripled. And a lot of kids coming out of university decide to stay. There's like, I think, a little wave of entrepreneurship going on there. But, and this is not a bad thing, but it sounds like a bad thing to most Americans. No big plans, no big things happened. You know, there were a lot of big things announced. The mayor announced a big rebuilding program and a big jazz museum. Never happened. There's a sign in the middle of downtown with an artist rendering of an 80-story new Trump building. It is sun faded now. That's the only thing Trump is ever going to put up in New Orleans, is that sign. These are good things.
Yeah.
But to the rest of America, that looks like, oh. But, you know, the city is growing back organically, not, you know, with what was feared, old, Disneyfied, corporatized, gentrified version of it, you know, parody of itself.
Mayor Giuliani.
Yeah, it's not that. It's still New Orleans. It's still a majority black city, for example, which most people don't know. It's still got it. And yet there are 100,000 people who were involuntarily evacuated from the city. No government or non-government agency has kept track of them. We don't know where they are or how they're doing or whether they want to come back. So those two realities.
So it sounds almost like as much tragedy as this obviously was, that in many ways the city's almost growing back stronger and more what it was meant to be, more what it...
Well, you know, one hopes that... I mean, this, there's an activist in New Orleans who says... I was on an interview show with her on Al Jazeera English, of all places. They covered the story. And she said, you know, people keep calling us resilient. Well, I'm sick of being called resilient, because when I hear them calling me resilient, that means they're just getting ready to hit me again. She says, stop calling us dainty. But it is true. You know, it's a very resilient place. The city has undergone and survived a lot of hurricanes. It's the site of the last yellow fever epidemic on the North American continent in the early 20th century. I mean, all sorts of... It's a city of survivors. The reputation it has as a city of excess and of decadence, that's a reputation that comes a lot from the fact that we allow tourists to come down and act like that. But the city itself has a strong tradition of survival and perseverance through innumerable obstacles, and it's gone through this one.
And one of your witnesses says that she doesn't feel that the Army Corps of Engineers, now embarrassed by what happened, will allow it to happen again, that they'll actually get their act together and do things properly from now on. Do you share that faith?
No, I put her in there because she's a very smart person. She's a PhD. She's very dedicated to the community. She has to believe that to do her work every day. I don't think the Corps of Engineers has earned a scintilla of trust based on their record, based on their approach to problem solving, their approach to how they deal with things. I mean, Dr. B says that they're using the same low factor of safety in this new $15 billion system that they've had in the last system. Much lower than the factor of safety in rural dams. Factor of safety is just a cushion.
Right.
so that it exceeds specs. That's disturbing. What the whistleblower says about their willingness to install pumps that did not pass the tests is disturbing.
Breathtaking, actually, when you see them reduce the level at which you're going to test them time after
and they
time
still don't
and still
pass.
Fail.
Yeah. When you see that they built this canal through the wetlands of St. Bernard Parish, destroying those wetlands, despite predictions that that's exactly what it was going to do, and Congress says, close that thing, put a cork in it, and now mitigate and remediate the environmental damage you've done, and the Corps' first plan for that is to build a new canal through the wetlands. That doesn't make me trust them at all. Mm.
And how has all of this changed you, or has it? Has it really? I mean, people know you through Spinal Tap. People know you through The Simpsons and all of that, and all very funny.
Mm-hmm.
This obviously very serious and
mm-hmm.
very personal
mm-hmm.
For you.
Mm-hmm.
Has it changed your perspective on the world, or?
It's changed my perspective on the media. I grew up not only being a news junkie, but thinking seriously about working in that world and having worked in that world mm-hmm. and kind of understanding a lot about the people in that world. And it really did surprise me that they are now more interested in, apparently, in preserving their own or the audience's belief in them than they would be by saying, hey, you know what, after 5 years, there's new information.
Mm-hmm.
They just want to be able to say, we got it right. Hey, we did it. We did a wonderful job. You know, in the fifth anniversary, instead of coming to this information and saying, well, here's the rest of the story,
mm-hmm.
they were rerunning the tapes from 5 years ago saying, look at us, we were wagging our finger in Mary Landrieu's face. Mm-hmm. That's been pretty profoundly disappointing to me, that on the two major news stories of the first decade of the 21st century, the run-up to the Iraq War failure and the flooding of New Orleans, massive failure. That's not a good record.
What strikes me watching the movie, because this is an issue for me as well about the journalism, that what the story of the Corps of Engineers is very similar to the story of the media, in that they became so respected and presumed to be doing the best work that they somehow just became a functionary and no longer felt compelled to push more to compete that keep that facade and keep the business going than to keep the great work going.
I think what the Corps of Engineers has in common with even more than the media is the financial world. Because in both cases, they were not held answerable. Nobody from the Corps suffered any negative career consequences for almost destroying a city. Nobody from Wall Street has been prosecuted, even though we prosecuted hundreds of people after the savings and loan scandal. So you have, in both cases, what has been called a culture of impunity. And if you don't punish failure, knowing how humans work, you're likely to get more failure.
Hmm. So do you have a taste for documentary now?
I enjoyed making the film. That is to say, filmmaking is whether you're making it a comedy or a documentary, there's certain common elements. It's collaborative.
Mm-hmm.
You're problem solving all the time, especially working at a low budget. You're always having to, not only plan B, but plan L.
Mm-hmm.
I find that stimulating. And working with a great crew like we had in this, as we had in this film, mm-hmm. really satisfying and enjoyable and pulling, creativity out of as many people as possible and learning the different languages to talk to each person, mm-hmm. to get them. That always interests me. The struggle to get it out there
mm-hmm.
Has been extremely frustrating, and I'm not sure I want to go through that again.
Mm-hmm.
And I basically would rather fool around, at least for the next little while.
Yeah.
I did get an idea for the next one. And I'll give it away, look, there are great stories around, and clearly the 90 second or 2 minute 10 second package mm-hmm. that is standard on not only network but cable newscasts now, is not sufficient to tell a lot of, you know, we're living in this illusion of an information age,
mm-hmm.
but it's not the only thing that's missing is the information.
Well, I think if you choose to consume it, a lot of, I mean, I always say, I think there's now a phenomenon in documentary where you almost have to see two or three films to get a story.
Mm.
You know, it really is a commitment of 5 or 6 hours, not the hour and a half, because you combine, you know, Iraq documentaries and you're interested in what's happening in the front lines. There are 4 or 5. You kind of have to watch all of them to get.
Well, I think that's true in most cases because people are making documentaries with a very specific agenda. And that, you know, I really did bend over backwards to give the Corps enough time to answer the criticisms. You know, they're responsible for the job they did in answering, but
mm-hmm.
I'm not manipulating their answers, and I worked very hard to get people from the Corps in and to probably put as much of what we shot of them in the film as humanly possible, just to be able to say, mm. you don't have to see another movie to get their side
That's
of this
true.
Story. You know, it's there.
They don't have much of a side.
For better or worse, it's there. But, you know, I thought that was my responsibility to do that, you know, to not
yeah.
leave you with a one-sided kind of just screed,
yes.
even a well-informed, well-founded, scientifically based screed. I thought, you know, hearkening back to, you know, growing up with documentaries on TV
mm.
and seeing great ones, you know, this is what you do.
Yeah.
You put them on film, show them. I said, you know, I said to Karen Durham Aguilera, there's going to be a lot of criticism of your agency in the film. You need to be in it to respond to it. People need to see your response.
Mm. Well, I'd love to see that this film, you know, inspires another half dozen filmmakers to, instead of, you know, as we had that wave of films about the pain,
mm-hmm.
to now have a wave of films about, you know, the people and the real story and the cover-ups and the...
Well, I mean, I would love it to, you know, now that we have this Mississippi River flood situation as we speak, for people to look at the core other places,
mm-hmm.
you know, it is a big story, and it is having larger and larger consequences as time is going on. And you know, each little piece of it is treated as a separate story.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the New Orleans thing and the Mississippi River flood and this and that. So, you know, it's going to take a lot of blind men to get the elephant all up there.